Greetings, everybody, and welcome to Night 3 of the Dark Souls 3 Network Test. This is going to be the final night of recording, because this is the last night the NT will be available. And I've decided to do live commentary tonight, just because I know some people were looking forward to it. Since I've already played through the entirety of the PvE for the Network Test, I'm probably going to just be spending most of tonight's session doing fight clubs with Solbrandt and messing around with things. So I don't know how much footage I'm going to end up with. I am going to try the Northern Warrior to start off with here, because this is a class I haven't tried. I want to mess around with the weapon a little bit. I feel like I've gotten a reasonable sense for how the caster classes work, but I want to mess around a little bit more with the melee classes, or at least melee builds, because the classes in the Network Test here are strictly Network Test classes. They probably do not represent the names or loadouts that are going to be available as starting classes in the retail version of the game. And in fact, I can pretty much guarantee they don't, just because the none of the previous Network Tests have had anything like that. So let's see, we've got this shield seems to... Okay, so I guess this is our buff. I'm going to have to mess around with this, but I'm fairly sure this is just an attack buff. I think I remember this being explained at the E3 demo as an attack buff. And then we can block with it, two-hand it. Okay, yeah. So this is kind of like a war cry. I'll have to compare the damage this does on an enemy with and without, but I'm fairly sure, just based on the color of the aura and on how long it lasts, that it's probably an attack buff. We'll grab this. I think I'm going to just play far enough through the PvE of the Network Test to get a couple of the weapons that I want. I definitely want the Greatsword. I probably am going to want to mess around with the Legion Scimitars on this build as well. And I think also I'm going to undeafen myself on Mumble, so that once everybody in Solbrandt gets their fill of whatever else is going on, I'll know when they start the fight clubs, so I can wander on over and join them. I'm not quite sure how I'm even going to cut this footage together, but I suspect it probably will be a combination of what little PvP I'm going to be doing and the PvE.
You can't two-hand.
Oh, there's Number Frosty. One. Actually, maybe I'll just unmute myself already.
Two-handing is not a thing.
Hi, Frosty.
There's no... Well, hello.
How's it going?
Good. I tested something quickly.
What'd you
there
find?
There is no battle art for the fist.
There's not.
So instead, if you press L2 with the kite shield, for instance, you will do a bash. And the bash does bump damage.
Does it have significant stun lock properties or anything like that?
Not that I can see. It's not so much a bash as it's like an overhand swing and you just happen to be holding a shield.
Ah.
So.
How are you getting your bare fist as a usable weapon?
Swap weapons as soon as you start.
Right, I see. I just saw it now. I just realized. I keep forgetting that that slot then gets taken up once you start gathering weapons. So let me actually try that out now. So with a weapon art, even if you have a shield, or rather with your fist, even if you have a shield that that
as
normally...
A weapon art option, you don't use a weapon art because there's no weapon art for the...
So I see. And actually, this is the exact same shield bash from Dark Souls 1, it looks like.
I'm not sure. I'm on the kind of knight character.
Oh, okay. I took the Northern Warrior, the, like, barbarian axe guy. Actually, now that I think to ask, I'm recording right now. I was just explaining to my viewers that I have no idea how tonight's recording session is going to play out. But,
gotcha.
What is the effect of the weapon art for this battle axe? Is it an attack buff, as I suspected it was?
So, press R2 before you use the weapon arc and see what the moveset looks like. Okay.
It seems to be like a shout with a small AoE knockback.
Yeah, well, that's what the arc itself is, but what happens is the shout gives you what I seems to be about a 20% increase in damage.
Right.
But the shout also modifies your R2.
Oh, it
so
does.
You have a different R2 when the shout is active than if you didn't have the shout active.
Okay. Let me experiment with that again. So, just the R2 moveset then, you said, not the R1s?
Oh my god, I instantly... invasion.
Really?
Like, the second I went to invade... It
God. People have been figuring out about fight clubs, I think.
Yeah, I think that's it. I think there's just more people hosting, so there's more eligibility for people to actually invade.
Well, that seems to be what they wanted from what we discussed the other day, at least as far as we can tell.
Yeah.
Alright.
Also, hello. Hello, everybody. Hey, high scores. What I think I'm going to do is maybe the last hour or so, I'll set it for... I'll do something where I make it so that we can test things that people want to test, and I'll do some moveset recordings and things of that nature.
Actually, Frosty, it'll be nice to have, at least for some amount of time, I don't want to just completely dominate your stream, but since you've had more of a chance to experiment with a lot of these things than I have, it'd be nice to bat some ideas back and forth as well, and possibly I could help you test things if you need a second.
Sure.
Okay, yeah, I definitely see that the R2 moveset after you use this shout, jeez, is a lot more aggressive. And you said the other day that it's possible to charge the second hit of an R2 chain? Like, to charge the follow-up?
Say that again?
Charging follow-ups to R2 attacks, like the second hit in an R2 chain.
Oh, yeah, so if you press R1 and then press R2, your character will combo the attack and already be charging as R2.
Oh, wow!
Oops, okay.
I'm almost dead, too. Still has quite a significant wind-up time, it seems.
Yeah, of course. But it's just, if you want to do a charge attack, you can kind of combo it in that sense.
Okay, excellent.
Also, Arby Frosty will be doing this Solbrant podcast after test. I've been wanting to do the Solbrant podcast all day, but trying to get people together...
The best laid plans, right?
...to it is fucking impossible. I liken it to trying to herd, like, attention deficit disorder cats. Or cats that have attention deficit disorder. Trying to herd them is kind of how it feels like trying to organize recordings for, like, a podcast and stuff. Because I am the one who gets to organize everybody to record the stuff and then edit the stuff and then get topics, and it's just... I took it upon myself to actually do everything. All people have to do is show up and be ready. It's still an issue, but...
Well,
whatever.
Some of us were enjoying hot, luxurious baths and couldn't be bothered to put in an appearance.
There you go, right?
Don't tell Peeve I said that. Oh, and I see, Frosty, as well, that the... After using the shout on this axe, the charged attack, if you charge the R2, now becomes... Oh, and it has hyper armor.
It's an entirely different attack, yeah.
Wow. Hyper armor, and it seems to be a launcher, or it sends the smaller hollows here flying anyway. And it's two hits. Wow. Yeah, so these weapon arts have really grown on me. They were a little bit weird to me at first, getting used to this system, but... I think now I really like it. All right, Frosty, I think I'm going to mute slash deafen myself a little bit, give you guys your stream a break from me, but if you reach a point where you feel like a little bit of company, message me.
Yeah, thank you.
Cool. Thank you.
I'm gonna do some invasions for now, and then we'll kind of see what happens.
Okay, yeah, I think I might try that out as well. If there's more activity tonight than there has been, then maybe it's actually worth spending a little bit of time trying to invade.
Ooh, that was a fucking weird hit. Jesus.
I'll catch you in a bit, Frosty. Take care, Frosty stream.
Thanks, bye. Bye-bye.
Take care. All right. Now that all of that has been taken care of, this actually should be fairly seamless, since this is live commentary, and I have everything set up so that it will be synchronized more or less automatically once everything is mounted in Premiere. And I think if I use an ember... Oh no, I guess not. I thought that if you were a Lord of Cinder, there was some option to offer a flame to these things, but I guess that's... I hadn't been paying close attention. I guess that's just the way that it works, regardless of your form. So here's the great sword. And I noticed before that we've got a smaller shield for parrying. Oh, and look! It's Benhart's shield. Okay. Alright, I see how this works. Oh, and I see also that even if you have the parrying shield equipped, if it's on your back, if you're two-handing your weapon, you still get the weapon art. Interesting indeed. And I suspect... Okay, yeah. I guess maybe I should spend a little bit of time... I wanted to just demonstrate briefly a couple of the attacks that I mentioned in yesterday's recording session, and then kind of either forgot to use or forgot whether I had used them off camera or not. And it ended up being that the ones I did think I'd used off camera, I did show, but I want to talk about them while I have the opportunity to do so with LiveCon. I want to first lure this guy over here, and actually, I want to get rid of that bastard, so I think... There. With him out of the way, first of all, the guard break. Oh, great, and there's another archer. This guy with the shield, I talked about the other day how if an enemy is blocking, and it works this way for player characters as well, you can just sort of walk up and kick their guard open, but... Oh, I think I succeeded there, but I misread it. And if you don't actually hit them when they're blocking, it'll just knock them back a bit, as it did in Dark Souls 2. He's gonna attack me, I think. Gotta just... Oh, hit him while he's repositioning. There we go, okay. So, I just wasn't familiar enough with that frontal stagger animation, where they're susceptible to it, but I guess I did pull it off successfully the first time. So yeah, you can kick somebody's guard open with the kick attack, or else just break it by depleting their stamina, and then perform that. And it seems particularly potent against other players in this build, just because attacks seem to consume a lot more stamina, and they also seem to deplete a lot more stamina. So, as far as I can tell, it's easier to have your guard broken in Dark Souls 3, at least based on the network test, than it was in some of the previous games. Come on, dragon. Deal with these guys for me. Thank you. Ah, damn it. And here's the backstab. The backstab mechanics we covered, or I think really Frosty covered. He uploaded a highlight from his stream the other day, which I think I'm just going to link in the video description, where he did a focused demonstration of how backstabs work in this game. And he really described it better there than I can here. But... Boy, I'm glad I survived that. But what it amounts to is that the backstab window is a lot shorter. And the actual the area of effect for the backstab, the cone behind the player character in which somebody else can initiate the backstab, is considerably narrower as well. But there's now also a delay where if you... I'm going to just open this shortcut. And this is the shortcut I was talking about the other day that was directly underneath the dragon. And it turned out I did show it on camera. I thought for some reason I had shown it during that little section I cut when I hopped on Mumble to consult Frosty and Brandon about the talisman stuff, but... backstabs now have a delay between when the attacker initiates the backstab and when the target is drawn into the backstab animation. So it is possible now to miss a backstab in the same way that it was in Dark Souls 2, except that the backstab itself, unlike in Dark Souls 2, does draw you into a hard animation in which you have complete invulnerability and in which you cannot be damaged or knocked down or anything along those lines. So it's basically the Demon Souls Dark Souls 1 backstab system, just with a small, probably I'd say maybe half a second window during which the target can actually escape. And if the target does escape the backstab attempt... Oh, right, I got that already. If the target does escape the backstab attempt, the person initiating the backstab will still perform the backstab animation, or at least the first hit of it. So you can go to backstab somebody, and you can just be caught standing there if they avoid it, and then you're vulnerable. And they can turn around and either hit you while you're locked into that backstab animation for the first hit, or they can parry the backstab attack. Because if you miss a backstab, you still perform that first initial hit, and that is counted as an attack. And if somebody walks back into that backstab attack animation, they can still be hit and damaged by it. So it basically, if you miss a backstab, your backstab attempt just becomes a normal physical attack that has all of the other properties of a physical attack, such as being vulnerable to parries and... Just get out of here. But yeah, such as being vulnerable to parries and having the ability to deal damage to any unit that walks into it. So, it's very interesting in that regard that they've gone with that system, but it ends up being as close to a happy medium as I think they're ever going to achieve under the old or anyway pre-existing systems. And what it means for the viability of backstabs is that they are still viable, but they are no longer such an easily abusable method of dealing damage while being invulnerable that that's the only thing you should do. So now backstabs are going to... if you plan on using a backstab, you have to be a lot more sure that it's actually going to land, because if you miss it, there's a much higher likelihood that you are going to end up regretting missing it and that you'll be made to pay for it. So is backstab fishing still a thing? It will be to some extent, but there was actually an upload from Nico Nico Doga where somebody re-uploaded a vid from Nico Nico where they were basically messing around with pure backstab fishing in the network test. And this was clearly the original player who had uploaded it to Nico was obviously very skilled in backstab fishing. But even somebody of that level of skill was only able to achieve a kind of 50-50 success with backstab fishing. And it's very clear from watching this video how much more punishable backstab attempts are now. I'll link the video in the description. What I got out of it primarily was that backstabs are still pretty viable in PvE, but based on the video, as well as my own experience in the fight clubs with the Solbrandt guys over the course of the network test, it seems a lot like backstabs have been very specifically and deliberately toned down for PvP in particular. I noted in the video especially that things like counter backstabs, strafing around somebody as they attempt to backstab you, and roll backstabs seem to be a lot less effective. Now, there's one thing I did want to check out, which I didn't really have an opportunity to explore in yesterday's recording. The other tower here, the one opposite, which I think is... yeah, over that way. I want to just go see if there's actually anything important over there. Because there were a couple of dogs on the way, there's just a super gank, and a couple of other enemies as well. Some guys with really potent hyper armor, and stuff I really don't want to mess with. Just make sure I didn't miss anything up here either. No, okay. Look carefully ahead. I guess this is in reference to the fact that we were using this spot as pretty much bleachers for our fight clubs. Praise the gorgeous view. Yeah, I can get on board with that. All right. It looks like I haven't missed anything major. And I want to clarify something I said yesterday about the Estus Flask charges in the beginning of the PvE recording. I said that it looks like you'll have the ability to dedicate levels of upgrade either to your Estus Flask or your Ash Estus Flask, this one here. You can't do that in the network test. That's what I wanted to clarify. But we surmised that by totaling up the combined number of charges that every character has for both Estus Flasks. And we noted that in the case of every demo character we have for this build, they all add up to 13 charges. Which is what led us to speculate that in the retail version of the game, that's how upgrading the Estus Flask is probably going to work. You'll just be able to choose whether you dedicate the bulk of your flask charges to your HP restoring flask or your focus restoring flask. And it seems pretty clear here that they did not want you jumping onto that little railing over there. These statues are... they're clearly blocking that. They don't want you walking around all of this. Then they want you to have to fight these guys. Which is interesting. I think, in a lot of ways, the level design and enemy placement in the network test, even though, to some extent, it's probably not final, it shows that they're, I believe, finally starting to understand the sorts of shortcuts, and you can see there the little jerky motion that happens when the enemy gets sucked into the backstab occurs a very brief period of time, fractions of a second after I actually initiate the backstab animation, and in that window the target can escape. So that actually, I think, one of the main effects it's going to have is limiting things like vacuum backstabs, where on your screen you're 15 feet away from your opponent and they initiate a backstab and then you get sucked into it from across the zone. But yeah, as far as level design, I think they're probably, through the feedback that they've been getting directly from community members at these PR events, as I described in yesterday's PvE recording session, I believe they're finally starting to grasp the way that players who are familiar with these games and maybe more skilled at playing them approach these sorts of situations. For example, as I'm doing now, luring these guys one by one, and unfortunately I had to go right into the thick of them and get the attention of more than one enemy at once in order to bring them down here, but... based on that understanding, it seems to me that they are now throwing some curveballs into the level design for one, but the enemy placement and enemy behavior for another. And I see there that there's one archer who is probably not planning on following me, but then there's this guy with the axe who, as I've learned... Oh, and now there are two. Interesting as well that that second axe guy who was down below, down the stairs, did not walk up and start attacking me until I had already gotten the attention of the first one up above. And that's kind of what I mean. I think that they know how people are going to be approaching these situations and are now taking measures to throw a wrench into the gears of the way that we would normally handle that. All right. On the other hand, with the weapon arts, they seem to have given us fairly potent tools for dealing with those curveballs. Oh, I think this is the first enemy in the entire network test in all three nights I've played it that has actually dropped an item for me. that's funny. But yeah, it's clear to me that whereas in the past, they really haven't had any connection at all with at least their Western community. They haven't been paying much attention to it, if any. Now they're starting to incorporate feedback and use that to build a better game. Like, I felt like a lot of the areas in Dark Souls 2, for example, were very linear, and they just kind of brought you on straight paths through a fairly mundane area. Aldia's Keep was probably the most guilty of that. Although, it was an issue to some extent in the Shrine of Amana, and particularly a couple of other areas like the Dragon Shrine, but in Bloodborne they had a different issue where, and I guess that's all that's up here. I don't think there are any secret areas in the NT. No, it doesn't seem like it, but I guess that's everything. But yeah, in Bloodborne they had a different issue. We're in... Oh, wow! Look at that. Okay, there you can see very clearly a low-res texture. And I want to finish my thought about Bloodborne, but I do want to talk about this as well. Bloodborne had the issue where the level design in terms of the areas was generally really good. They had the looping back on themselves and the intricacies of area, but it felt to me like they were just over too quickly. You'd clear an area in just a few minutes, and Bergenworth was one such area in particular, although I guess that was kind of designed to be an extension of the Forbidden Woods. But after you got through Central Yharnam, which was a fairly large area on its own, and then the Forbidden Woods itself was quite large, after that, I kind of felt like the areas just started to be really small. The Nightmare of Mensis was fairly intricate, but that again was a lot of looping back on itself, and that had a lot of vertical size, where it really wasn't that big an area, there were just a lot of floors in the tower. Whereas here, it does have that sufficiently wide open feel, and we can see off in the distance, much of the area that's visible from here, we can actually walk on. And there is a significant amount of verticality to these areas as well, as I think probably became apparent in yesterday's recording, but they feel open too, whereas in Bloodborne, and especially in Dark Souls 2, I didn't quite get that feeling. But as to the low-res texture, this sort of thing is a trick that they use in game development, and I don't think they meant for anybody to look over here. I suspect this wooden barrier may well be temporary, because it looks like that area over there may be something that we'll be able to explore in the retail version of the game. But for right now, clearly it's not finished, or else it's never intended to be explored. And they've got what may well be a temporary barrier blocking it off. But what they'll do as a way of making the game's rendering process more efficient and saving memory, is when you're close to something, you will see a high-resolution texture. And you can kind of look at the ground here underneath me and see that this texture for the cobblestones and the bonfires and the general environment with the vines and the candles and the statue is pretty detailed. This is a high-resolution texture. Compare that to the texture down there, which is blurry, not very sharp at all, and it really looks more like a PS2 game than a PS4 game. That's a low-res texture, and the way that it works is based on proximity to the player. You can kind of think of it as a bubble around your player character, and anything in that bubble, the game will load in as the high-res texture. And then when you walk outside of the range at which the game will load those high-res textures in, anything that's visible to you from beyond the limits of that bubble, the game will instead load a texture like that down there, the low-res texture, which at a distance, you won't really notice most of the time, unless it's just really egregious and blatant and just painted onto a flat surface. And that's the game's way of helping to run more efficiently so that you don't get frame drops or any kinds of crazy things that ruin your immersion or just make the game unplayable. And I'm explaining that now because there really aren't too many opportunities for me to do that in builds that I am allowed to publicly upload, or at any rate, that I know I won't be DMCA'd for publicly uploading. If I were allowed to upload stuff from a debug build, boy, could I show all kinds of really fascinating mechanics of the behind-the-scenes stuff, and I would love to do that, but unfortunately I can't. The debug builds of these games are very strictly protected under NDA, and uploading anything from those builds is a very serious violation. Periodically, I get questions from people and private messages saying, "Franz, why can't you just show us stuff from a debug build?" And really, that's why. As much as I wish I could, it's just the sort of thing that it causes all kinds of trouble with NDA. And if you violate NDA, all kinds of terrible things happen. The developer can end up suing you for millions of dollars, and it's just terrible, terrible stuff. Really bad news. And having the privilege of participating in a network test like this for such a highly anticipated game, violating NDA is the last thing I want to do. You know, I have to show a certain amount of integrity and let Bandai Namco know that, yes, they can trust me not to do something that is an egregious violation of NDA, and that I can be trusted to participate in events like this in the future. And it isn't just me. Technically, everybody who participates in things like open betas and this network test almost invariably will have to click an I agree button after scrolling to the bottom of an end user license agreement, or EULA, before even being allowed to access the content in question. And usually EULAs just say things like, you agree to forfeit the soul of your firstborn child if you're found to be in violation of any of the EULA principles. But nevertheless, everybody has a responsibility to abide by these, and it's not just people like me who are more in the public eye. I'm going to go grab the Legion scimitars, I think, and then head back to join up with whoever from Solbrandt is involved in the fight clubs, or whatever else may be going on. I'll just... Oh, right, and... Okay. Toast's up there as well, it seems. Wait for him to make one more pass. What? Oh! Right, there's a guy down there shooting him. Come on, dragon! There we go. That's better. But he missed this guy. I guess I'll just have to deal with it myself. Okay, I'm going to... Hopefully I won't get hit up here. Have to walk forward just far enough to trigger the dragon to breathe fire. And then run through afterward. Just like in Demon's Souls. There he goes. Oh, and he got that stupid archer too. Excellent. So now it's just shield dude. And there you go. I really appreciate the fact that these critical attacks, backstabs, and riposts are still viable, but that they're not going to be the be-all and end-all. And I mean, provided this isn't some fluke and they work completely differently in retail than they do in the NT, I think it seems fairly promising. We may be able to... Wow, and I even was able to kick aside a tower shield like that. That's... Boy, this guy really wants it. And it seems, actually, I was even able to break his guard as he was initiating that shield bash. Fascinating. But yeah, what it all boils down to is that unless something major changes from here to retail, and I don't think it will, I think that this is probably a fairly close representation, as far as the backstab and parry systems anyway, of what we can expect in the retail version of the game. And that gives me some hope that the PvP in this game will not see the kinds of just flagrant backstab fishing that a lot of people were rightfully upset about in Demon's Souls and Dark Souls 1. Dark Souls 1 particularly. I know a number of people are probably going to be calling me out on this in the comments, when I said in yesterday's recording during the boss fight that most people liked and or did not complain about Demon's Souls or Dark Souls 1. And I think overall that is the case. I think there are far fewer people who complain about those games than there are those who complain about Dark Souls 2 and Bloodborne. And Dark Souls 1 in particular, as far as community sentiment is concerned, Dark Souls 1 seems to be viewed as the defining Souls game. The definitive Souls game, anyway. And I see far less criticism of that game than I seem to of really any of the others. I guess you can't parry this guy's shield dash. You can parry that, though! Fantastic. That being the case, though, even still, one of the main things in Dark Souls 1 that people did complain about was the fact that backstabs were so easy to exploit in that game. And I don't know how many of you are familiar with Jerp Does Games. He's a member of Soulbrant, but kind of one of the more outspoken members. He has he operates a small Twitch channel and unfortunately doesn't draw a lot of traffic, which to me is a real shame because he's a very smart guy and he is one of the most skilled of the Western community members at analyzing mechanics and figuring out how things work in the Souls games. And much of his opinion certainly is maybe not in line with what is commonly held in the community. But if you consider yourself open-minded enough to be able to agree to disagree, you really should check him out, because he's got some excellent insights into things like the way backstabs work and how to spec out the most optimal builds for various purposes. I'm not suggesting that you go watch his VODs and learn how to master the art of being a backstab fisher, but there's a lot to be learned just from what he has to say in general. And I bring him up because he, in particular, is one of the ones who has really improved my understanding of how these mechanics work. And probably he'll have some very interesting insights on Dark Souls 3's mechanics as well. But more to the point, he helped me to understand better than anyone just how bad the problem of backstabs being broken in Dark Souls 1 was. And even as much praise as that game gets... Whoops. Totally miscalculated that. If you watch some of Jerp's older videos, his VODs and highlights and stuff, from Dark Souls 1, even people like myself, who really loved and enjoyed Dark Souls 1, really have no grounds to defend the backstab system in that game. And I wanted to address that after having commented yesterday that, yeah, Dark Souls 1 and Demon Souls are the ones that almost nobody complains about and that everyone seems to love. Yeah, I still genuinely believe that, but I also acknowledge that, come on, where is the... There it is. I want to acknowledge that they definitely had some pretty glaring and egregious issues. In Demon Souls, it was mainly the spell swap glitch, which was never fixed. But in Dark Souls 1, I think it really had more to do with backstabs than anything else. And I cheesed this thing with firebombs the other day. I think it's only fair for me to demonstrate just what a nasty enemy this thing is if you attempt to fight it up close. Yeah. That's what happened to me the first night when I tried to fight it head to head. I did it for all of you. For the sake of being fair and showing everything I possibly can. Because I know that there are going to be a lot of people who were not fortunate enough to be... to win the lottery for access to the network test. This jerk. Probably already too late to stop him from summoning these guys. And I know that a lot of people are relying on YouTube coverage and Twitch coverage from people like myself and other members of the community who did get into the network test as their way of getting news and information about this build of the game. And I want to do the best I possibly can to show the widest possible variety of material from the NT. Because this is really all we're going to get until retail, more than likely. I doubt they're going to do anything else with this other than maybe show it at another upcoming event like PAX East or something like that. It may be playable there, but beyond that, I don't think there are going to be any other opportunities for anybody to record footage of the game in a home setting with access to professional or somewhat professional recording equipment. Most of what's come out of PAX and Gamescom so far has been recorded with people's cell phones and really has been just kind of very patchy. And they were really weird about recording that footage at Gamescom anyway, from what I heard, and at PAX as well, where, like, on the first day or two of those conferences, they weren't really making a big deal about it, and they were kind of letting people record with their cell phones. But then later on, for some reason, they got much more... much more closed, I guess, about it. And went out of their way to say to people, no, don't do that. We're not okay with this anymore, for some reason. See if I can... There we go. The charge attacks feel really good. They feel really, really good. And let me see if I can... I glossed over it yesterday, but... In yesterday's recording session, when I jumped down this ladder, I landed on this guy's head. And it became clear to me then that the Goomba Stomp is definitely going to be a thing in Dark Souls 3. And I appreciate that, although... I mean, it'd kind of be good if it's not such a... if the stun lock from it isn't quite as bad. I still can't quite tell what happened there. I guess that guy just transformed into this thing or something? I'm not rightly sure. I'm going to try... Well, let's see if he responds to alluring skulls, first of all. He turned toward it, maybe, but I guess he doesn't care. I want to demonstrate the weapon art of the greatsword, because I've really not been giving it the attention it deserves. It does have some hyper armor, which... That lunge starts off the attack with hyper armor, and then, this, the uppercut, boy, that's, for some reason, I don't remember it doing quite as much damage as it, did just there. But then again, the weapon arts, I don't want to say that they're the new backstabs, because they're just as easy to avoid and punish, maybe even a little bit easier to avoid and punish, as actual backstabs and riposts are. And I'm going to put a link in the description of this video. Probably it's already in the description of yesterday's video as well, to Gibbs' highlight of my duel with him in yesterday's Fight Club. Screw you, stupid archer. And it's interesting to see that from his end, because one of the things I noticed only when I went back and watched his highlight of it was that it looked surprisingly similar on his side to the way it looked on my side, whereas thinking back to some of the previous Souls games, and in fact pretty nearly all of them, seeing a fight from somebody else's end usually looked a lot different than it would to me when I was actually participating in the fight. And the fact that there's, to me anyway, in the network test here, noticeably less discrepancy seems to suggest that whatever netcode they're using in the NT appears to be substantially more reliable than in previous games. Now, I don't know how significant that's going to end up being. I personally do notice a difference, but I don't know that that difference is going to be... Ah, there we go. And this is the true beauty of these weapon arts. I don't believe he actually hit me during that initial... And here's what it is. I'll just show it. This is the lunge. And I don't know if lunge is even quite the right word, but... You go into this stance. And during that stance, you have hyper armor and cannot be knocked out of it by most normal attacks, as far as I can tell. A really heavy hit from an axe, like that big fat guy down in the courtyard below me, that probably will still knock you out of it regardless, but, it may also be that you actually need, focus, you need MP, in order to be able to have hyper armor on this. Because just the lunge itself does consume focus. But you have hyper armor on this, and then you can either follow it up with the launcher, which, if you don't have enough focus for the launcher, you can see there that it does not have that blue trace on the attack. And from the tests that I've done so far, if you try and use this launcher without enough focus to get the trace, it will not actually launch enemies. So they kind of limit the abusability of weapon arts in that regard by tying them to focus, as well as you can go into the lunge and then instead just follow it up with a regular R1. And even if you do have a full focus meter for this, the R1 follow-up seems to be just your regular attack. So it's interesting to me in that regard as well. With this shield, we can still perform the lunge and then combo into the launcher one-handed as well. So you don't have to perform this weapon art with your sword held in both hands, which I'm profoundly glad for. I'm very, very grateful. I'm gonna try and pick up a few more throwing knives, and then I'll go downstairs and troll the hell out of that fat guy, now that I know how ridiculously effective throwing knives are against him. You and your stupid firebombs. Screw you. And screw you too, jerk behind the breakable pots. Great. Throwing knives. Actually, I think the amount of throwing knives I have now should be just enough. Damn it, I forgot about that guy. Ah, nice, idiot. Those recovery frames from landing. Oh, and he dropped some items too. More throwing knives. Ask and you shall receive, I guess. There's one other guy in here. I think he comes over the... Yeah, look at him. Just waiting there. And some firebombs. Okay, I think there might be another item or two over here. Yeah, I think this is some throwing knives or something. Yes, it is. Go through this. Ah, right, there's that room. I don't think I'm going to play all the way through the PvE portion of this game now, and I think actually once I've gone down and taken care of Smo 2.0 down there, I think I'm just going to wander off and see what everybody is up to in Solbrandt. I think there's an ambush down here too. A couple of guys who are up to no good started climbing over railings in the neighborhood. Alright, yeah, this should be enough. I don't think he saw me. I'm gonna wait for him to circle back around again, now that I know how he works. No, he didn't see me. I thought for sure he'd spotted me. Oh, now he did. Alright. Let's hopefully not have a repeat of yesterday. Yeah, look at this. Look at this DPS. This is nuts. Oh, now he's running. Now he wants it. He's probably going to use that spin attack again. God, that range. Oh, this is bad. Nope. Not falling for that a second time. Ha! Nice. And still no drop. Although, all things considered, I think that went far better than it did yesterday. Now, I think there were some items around here somewhere. Fairly sure there were... Oh, that's where this guy came from! He was sitting over here in the corner the whole time. I kind of figured it'd be something like that. I figured he'd probably... Either he was hiding down here all along, or that he slid down the ladder from up above and chased me in from elsewhere. Let me just make sure. Right, there's one there. More throwing knives. I guess maybe the fact that they placed throwing knives here was a not-so-subtle hint that that's what they wanted you to use against him. Maybe that was entirely intentional. Oh, and now I can actually get the item up here that I forgot to pick up the other day, because I know somebody was yelling at me. Yeah, see, there we go. Just hyper-armored right through that. And launched him. And you can pivot with this. You can change the direction of it, I believe. I believe if we go... Yeah! So you can pivot a full 180 degrees with this launcher. Alright, what was this item? I guarantee you it was nothing good, as I said yesterday. Yup, one alluring skull. See, everybody who was yelling at me? I told you it was worthless. Okay. So I think that's going to wrap us up for now. Unless something really hilarious happens on my way back to the bonfire, which I somehow doubt it will. With my luck, it'll just be a boring, ordinary run back, so I'm just going to cut that and spare everybody. Alright, I actually got an idea. There is something I've been meaning to test out, which I saw in the options menu on the first night, and it made me really curious. This allows for manual control of aiming of large weapons when locked on. So as far as I can tell, this seems to be the same system that Dark Souls 2 used for its targeting. And I wanted to experiment with that and find out. Let's get rid of these guys first, because I don't want too many targets. And that punk over there is going to summon these guys. Alright. Well, damn. I was hoping to keep at least one of them alive. There we go, okay. So, it is! It's exactly the system from Dark Souls 2. Interesting. So, you know what? This is great, because it means that people who preferred this method of targeting in Dark Souls 2 can have it in Dark Souls 3. And those like myself who hated it don't have to deal with it. So they've given us the choice. That is fantastic. So I'm going to turn that off, because I personally do hate it. God, you know, that... I think... And I mean, I'm still looking at this as it has the potential to be a really good game, rather than it is a really good game. Because as I explained yesterday, this is still only the network test. It's going to be released in April. A lot can happen between now and then. And it will be some time before the game is even content locked, much less finished enough to be ready for a final evaluation, you know? But I dare say this already has a great deal more potential and a great deal more promise than I think really either Dark Souls 2 or Bloodborne did. Even the network test in Bloodborne had some pretty glaring things. Like, the difficulty with multiplayer connections during the network test in Bloodborne was an immediate red flag. There were a number of red flags in the Dark Souls 2 NT, although, unfortunately, that didn't become quite so clear until we actually hit retail. But at any rate, I want to... I'm looking over at Mumble now, and I see that pretty nearly everybody in Soulbrant and most of my other friends who are not affiliated with Soulbrant are still just addressing their streams. They all have themselves muted and deafened in Mumble, meaning they're just taking some alone time with their respective streams. So I think for the purpose of showing as much as I possibly can, I'm actually going to switch over to the sorcerer character, the mage. I've demonstrated pretty nearly everything else so far. I got to show the battle axe a little bit, gave a brief demonstration of the moveset of this weapon. The only thing I haven't tried so far is the mage, and I did show the knight on the first evening of the test, but apart from the longsword that that class carries, which you guys have probably seen elsewhere, the longsword has a weapon art very much like this axe, except with the longsword's weapon art, you just go into a stance, which you maintain by holding L2. Matter of fact, what the hell? We'll just, I'll show that briefly as well while I'm at it. We'll go to quit game. And I'll just very briefly log in as the knight character and show the longsword's moveset. It's almost exactly the longsword from Dark Souls 1, though. So there's not going to be really too much there other than the weapon arts. But I guess it's probably worth showing. The footage from Night 1 was all lost, and the commentary was ruined by those terrible issues, so we'll just take a minute here. This is pretty standard. You've got the regular horizontal moveset. And actually, in Dark Souls 2, I've been told that the longsword is a really, really powerful weapon if you know how to use it. So it may be... I don't know quite off the top of my head how similar this is to the longsword moveset in Dark Souls 2. But it seems definitely very similar to the Dark Souls 1 longsword at any rate. And this is the weapon art stance for this weapon. You hold L2 to maintain this stance, which differentiates it from other weapons like the battle axe, which you only press L2 and then it just gives you that buff. You don't have to hold L2 with the battle axe, nor do you have to hold L2 with the mace that the cleric is equipped with, because that does something very similar to the battle axe, except instead of giving you an attack buff, it gives you super armor or hyper armor. People seem to use those two terms interchangeably. I don't believe there's really that much difference between the two, if any. So in this stance, that's the R1 chain. And you'll note that maintaining this stance also slows the speed at which you recover stamina. And here's the R2. And let me just double check, but it does not seem you can charge the R2 in this stance, where you could charge the R2 with the buff in effect from the battle axe. And you might be able to charge it with the mace as well. I'm not sure. I didn't think to test that yesterday, actually. But yeah, these are the weapon arts of the longsword. And they do inflict a fairly heavy amount of damage as well as substantial stun lock. I don't believe they have any actual knockdown effects, and they certainly don't launch opponents. But yeah, there it is. So let me switch to the mage character, and we'll mess around a little bit with that. Oh, and another thing, actually. I wanted to show that there are, in fact, passwords in this game. So they've brought back the password matching system from Bloodborne, and we are able to switch back and forth between displaying other people's character names and character IDs. The reason this password is censored, I'm going to leave it as it is now, is because this is a password that Frosty had given me to join up with his fight club the other day. Apparently it's a private password, or one that he doesn't want getting out. So yeah, I'm just going to put a picture of some food or something on top of that. But you'll also note that there's an option for voice chat. I do not know quite how that works, because frankly, I never used it in Bloodborne. But worth noting that it's here nonetheless, and this will almost certainly make its way into retail. This was a good system, and combined with the fact that when you actually meet the matchmaking conditions, which again, it seems fairly likely now that there'll be a more normal set of conditions in the retail version of the game, and we won't be limited to only invading hosts that already have a Phantom with them in their world, being able to use password matching is going to make things a lot less painful for people trying to set up fight clubs and tournaments and that kind of thing. And even just for people who want to do some co-op with their friends. Although, I should mention that passwords do not affect invaders. If you are invading, you cannot use a password to match up with a particular host in this game. So, just want to make sure that I've made that clear. Brightness settings, basic music and stuff. I guess maybe it is important for me to show what's available in the menus here. And then again, just the basic options menu. This, though, this is amazing to me. I'm really impressed that they actually thought to add an option for this. Really, really impressed by that. So anyway, we're going to quit the game now and reload a mage character. All right, I believe it's the Academy Assassin. And I'm going to have to take a closer look at this character because it looks like the character might have a mask on. That would be pretty cool. And actually, another thing about this character is that I believe it's equipped with a spear. And this will give me an opportunity to demonstrate the moveset of the spear as well. And I think the weapon art for the spear is something kind of similar. Yeah, kind of similar to the longsword. In that it has kind of a rushing forward stab into an uppercut. Let's just jump down here, light the bonfire. Make sure we've rested. Peeve yesterday used this character for most of the fight clubs that we recorded. I think he might have used it on the first day as well. Let me just back myself up against a wall here. Yeah. Wow. Pretty cool. And we've got the tricorn hat going on here, so clearly somebody decided that a nod to Bloodborne was in order. And actually, it's not too bad. It does kind of match the set fairly well. I see that we've got a what looks like a tabard. And some fairly heavy clothing, anyway. Alright, we've got a round shield, a small one for parrying, clearly. And there's our wand, our, what do you call it, catalyst, and our torch, of course. So, alright. And you can charge the punch. That's funny. Wonder if it combos. It does, there's an uppercut. And I wonder... Yeah, you definitely can charge the second hit, so you can charge the uppercut as well. You just tap R2 once and then hold R2 a second time. Very cool. Very cool indeed. And interesting, it seems that if we don't have a weapon equipped in our right hand, we cannot two-hand the weapon in our left hand with triangle button. That, again, may change for retail. But interesting nonetheless. Alright, so first of all, let's mess around with the spear a little bit. Here's the... And actually, it bears mentioning, I know someone's going to ask me this as well. Can you attack from behind a shield? You can! Very good. Can you use the strong attack from behind a shield? No, it looks like, as in the previous games, you just lower your shield for it. So... Okay. Nothing new there. And here's the R2s. Again, nothing new. Let's try charging the R2. Okay. A much heavier thrust. And the backstep R1. Yeah, this is another thing that really amazes me. And again, this may only be in the network test. They may tweak this for retail, but look at how quickly the backstep attack comes out. You can almost... I don't think it quite counts as an animation cancel, because it's really just more you combo, or not combo, but you perform the attack fluidly out of the animation. I don't believe it's what would be considered a true cancel in the fighting game sense, like an animation cancel. But this is the full backstab animation with no other inputs afterward. And I should add that the backstep does not give you invincibility frames in this game. Solbrant has already tested that, and they can confirm that there are no iframes on the backstep. But look at how long the backstep itself is compared to how quickly that backstep attack comes out. And even the backstep R2, this is another weird thing to me. The backstep R2 attack, as well as, I believe, the running R2. Yeah, the running R2 attack as well. They're all just the jump attack. And that kind of saddens me a little bit, because I was hoping they would do what they did in Bloodborne, where each one of those different inputs had a unique attack animation. And they did in Bloodborne. So it saddens me a little bit that they didn't do that, but it's manageable, and I guess it's not the end of the world. Not a huge thing. So that's that. The running R1, just a running thrust. Okay. Now the R2s. Or rather, the two-handed moveset. Pure Dark Souls 1. The two-handed R2. Okay. Seems more like Dark Souls 1 than anything else. And then the charge is, again, the heavy thrust. And actually, I think this is the charging R2 from Dark Souls 2, now that I look carefully at it. So now the weapon arts. Let's see. L2. That's just tapping L2. So just tapping L2 is just that running stab. And this hits multiple times based on what I've seen of other people using it. And it seems you can combo it into the R2. So, okay. And it has no follow-up, but wow, that is interesting. So you can control its direction throughout almost the entire animation. The directional control becomes a little bit less precise towards the end. But wow, you can serpentine with this. So that must be what Peeve was talking about the other day when he said he wanted to experiment with serpentine with this spear. Very interesting indeed. And God, that backstep R1, that is ridiculously fast. All right. Okay, so I guess that's enough with the spear. Let's see. Okay, so we've got Soul Arrow, Soul Dart, and Soul Greatsword. Soul Arrow is... okay. Simple enough. And from what the Solbrant team has told me, the tracking on these spells is drastically increased over previous games. I'll have to test that out in a little bit, but it also seems that this consumes very little focus, very little MP. I'm glad also that this game's casting system is not dependent upon a number of charges. I really did kind of like the MP system in Demon's Souls, except that you could just buy stacks of 99 MP restoring items, and there were at least two items that restored MP. So you could just end up with a bottomless well of MP. I think by having an Estus flask for your focus in this game, they've once again found what seems to me to be a really very effective and well thought out happy medium. Come retail, we may figure out some completely broken bullshit with some of these mechanics that just isn't apparent to us now because we can't access the full systems that will be in the retail version of the game. But for now, it does look very promising. Now, I was talking about this the other day, but pressing L2 with Soul Arrow set. Okay, yeah, that buffs our hand. Oh, and I guess it's just a damage buff to anything else we cast while that's in effect. So let's try it with Soul Dart. Okay, interesting. So this is kind of a faster, probably less damaging Soul Arrow spell. And Soul Greatsword, those of us who've played Dark Souls 2 will probably be well familiar with this. Let's see. It's exactly the same, although the animation looks a hell of a lot nicer. And I wonder... Okay, so it seems that we cannot hold the cast for this spell as we could with the cleric and the miracles. Nor can we for this spell, nor this one. So I guess that must just be unique to talismans. Okay, interesting. So now I guess we might as well run a damage test to see how significant this buff actually is. So a regular soul arrow against that jerk over there. 88 damage. Buffed. 118 damage. So that's... This is just an estimate, but roughly in the neighborhood of a 20% increase. So not bad at all. Hmm. Alright, well... Let's see how the damage of this stacks up. Oh, and this seems to do no hyper-armor damage. But it appeared to have prevented him from calling his buddies. Alright, let's give Soul Greatsword a try. Oh yes, much more damage from that. And actually... 200. So if it does 200 even, then this will be a perfect test. Ah! Well, I got the buff out anyway. No, I didn't. Damn. Alright. Let's see, where is one guy that I... Here we go. Okay, so yeah, it seems to do 200 against all of these guys. So I'll buff, and... 220, it looked like? It's hard to say, let me try that again. Ah, not enough, damn it. Oh, it looked like 270. So maybe it's a more significant buff depending upon the spell. I'll have to go back and look at that during the editing. I'm sitting just far enough away from my TV that I couldn't quite tell if it said 220 or 270. But 220 would only be a 10% increase. 270 does make more sense. So yeah, I'll go back and look through it when I edit this. Very interesting nonetheless. Right. Well, and I'm seeing now that Peeve has just unmuted himself on Mumble, so I think I'm going to go get myself set up again with a with another character, a melee build, I think, or one better suited to melee, and go see what those guys are up to. So I guess I will catch all of you in about 1 second after a cut, as far as you're all concerned.